فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We were in the tafsir of Surah Al-Naba, and we stopped at Ayah 23. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, لابثين, they will stay in the hellfire, in it, أحقاباً. And we mentioned the three أقوال, the three views regarding the scholars in what it means by the word أحقاب. What does it actually mean? We took the three views there are. But I wanted to, inshallah wa ta'ala, mention the adillah, the evidences other than this evidence that has come to show that the disbelievers are going to be in the hellfire forever and they will never come out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-Hijr, Ayah 48, Allah says, وَمَا هُمْ and they are not مِنْهَا بِمُخْرَجِينَ. The disbelievers are not those who will be taken out of the hellfire. Once they enter the hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will never take them out. In Surah Al-Sajdah, Allah says, وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فَسَقُوا. The word فَسَقُوا here means kufar. It doesn't mean the mu'minin. فَمَأْوَاهُمُ النَّارِ. The hellfire will be their final abode. كُلَّمَا أَرَادُوا أَن يَخْرُجُوا مِنْهَا. Whenever they wish to come out, every time they want to come out, Allah says in this verse, وَعِيدُوا فِيهَا, they will be brought back into it. So they will always be brought back into the hellfire. And the word kullama in the Arabic language, it shows a takrar. That whenever they try to come, want to come out, or try to even come out, they will be brought back into it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in another ayah, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَأْتِ رَبَّهُ مُجْرِمًا. Anyone who comes to Allah, a criminal, here again it means the disbelievers. فَإِنَّ لَهُ جَهَنَّمَا. For verily that person, Jahannama, is his abode. لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا. He will not live in it, nor will he die. So look at this. It's a stage between life and death. They're not really receiving a real life, nor are they actually dying. Because you can imagine when a person reaches a point in their life where they want to die, and the people are going to wish to die that day. Allah also says in another ayah, كلما نضجت جلودهم بدلناهم جلودا غيرها ليذوقوا العذاب. Every time their skin finishes from the severe punishment of the hellfire and the heat of Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says to us, بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَذُوقُوا الْعَذَابِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives them a new set of skin so they can taste the pain of the hellfire. So it will never stop. It's a continuous cycle for them. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in a hadith, الإمام مسلم narrated من حديث أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه مرفوعا, that it will be said to the people of Jannah, خلود فلا موت. O you people in the hellfire, خلود, this is eternity, فلا موت, there's no death today. ويا أهل النار, O people of Jannah, people of Nar, خلود, this is your final abode, this is eternity for you, and there's no death, فلا موت. Aisha said, if anybody that day could die out of happiness, the people of Jannah would. And if a people could die that day out of distress and depression, the people of hellfire would. There is no way out of this. This is what they are going to be for the rest of whatever's going to be. There's no time. It's continuous. Eternity. It will never stop. وَلِذَلِكَ أَهْلُ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ believe that the khulud for the disbelievers is continuous. يريدون أن يخرجوا من النار وما هم بخارجين منها ولهم عذاب مقيم. They want to come out of the hellfire. They desire to come out of the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وما هم بخارجين منها. They will never be taken out of the hellfire. And Allah says for them, ولهم, and it is for them, عذاب, a punishment, مقيم, that will forever carry on. So if you've been in the hellfire, doesn't mean that the punishment stops. Even the punishment is also continuous. It's just that every time they receive a form of punishment, then another form of punishment will start. And then another form of punishment. Each time they are receiving a new form of punishment. May Allah protect us from it. وَلِذَلِكَ brothers and sisters, if a person wants to save a person, they should save them from kufr and should save them from shirk. This is something that Allah doesn't forgive. Allah does not forgive a person who comes with shirk. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah does not forgive a person who comes with shirk the Day of Judgment. Allah forgives any other sin that is below shirk. So if you have a family member who's indulging into shirk, or you know your family are not Muslims yet, or you know a person who you can give, guide them, the best gift that you can give to a person is to bring them into Islam and to save them from this punishment. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, in this fire, Allah is now going to describe it. قَالَ تَعَالَى, Allah says, لَا يَذُوقُونَ فِيهَا, they will not taste بَرْدًا وَلَا شَرَابًا. The Mufassireen, the scholars of tafsir, they differed amongst themselves what is meant by the word bardan. What does bardan mean? There's two views. The first view is, bardan here means a bardur rih. There's no wind. There's no air conditioner. There's no breeze that they're going to receive. The Jahannam's heat, the hotness, there is no breeze that they're going to receive. And also they're not going to receive no sleep. The bard here is a gnome. That's the second view. Their eyes are not going to be able to sleep, because the adab is going on for so long. So the people of hellfire, there is no sleep for them. The adab is continuous. Their eyes will not close. Their mind cannot shut. So Allah says, لَا يَذُوقُونَ, they are not going to taste, فِيهَا in Jahannam, بَرْدًا وَلَا شَرَابًا. They're not going to receive bard, which is the thing that they're looking for, which is they're looking for something cool. This cool here can either be a cool breeze, or it could also be what? Sleep. Neither of the two are they going to receive. وَلَا شَرَابًا, and they're also not going to be given anything to drink. They are thirsty. They want to drink. They're in a place, يَا إِخْوَةِ الْكِرَامِ, hotter than what you've ever seen. The Messenger told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that the heat that we receive when it's summer, and we think to ourselves, wow, 50 degrees Celsius in some countries in the world, and you think it's very hot. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, inna harra shamsi, the heat of the sun, the Prophet told us, is min fayhi jahannam. It's from the breathing of Jahannam. Jahannam ate itself, and it complained to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It said, oh Allah, this is my situation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made for Jahannam two times where it breathes. One of its breathings is in summer where the heat is so hot. The Prophet told us this is what it is. So that heat that we receive, which is far from us, Jahannam, they're in it, they're burning in it, and they want to drink. If somebody said to you in summer, in that heat, you're not allowed to drink anything, you will dehydrate and die. They're in it, and they are not allowed to drink anything. They are not going to receive any air conditioner, no hot, cold breeze. This is their punishment. Allah then says for them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only thing that they're going to taste, and the only thing that they're going to have go into their system is, illa hamiman wa ghassaqa. This is an exception. This is the only thing. Two things. The first one is hamiman. Hamiman is الْمَاءِ الَّذِي بَلَغَ النِّهَايَةَ فِي حَرَارَتِهِ, water that has reached the pinnacle of hotness. It's hot, boiling water would be given to them. They're thirsty. They're in Jahannam. They want cold water to drink. They're going to be given hot water. This is their punishment. وَغَسَّاقًا, غَسَّاق is two things. Two قول of the مُفَسِّرين. The first one is, they're going to be having the waste and the filth that has come from the people of hellfire. This is going to be added on to what they're going to drink, and they're going to be dull to drink. So they're going to drink from the waste of the people of the hellfire. And the filth that has come from their body, this is going to gather somewhere, and it's going to be poured for them, and it's going to be told for them to drink. The other thing is, they're going to drink the hellfire, zamharira, which is a punishment, jahannam. They're going to be poured zamharira, and they're going to be told, this is what you're going to have. So there's no cold juice or drink that they're going to have. Now a person needs to ponder here, needs to think, why is this happening to these people? Is Allah oppressing them, subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing injustice towards them? The answer to this question is what? There's a Vauxhall Astra SNZ, I think A78795. I think you're blocking someone or something. So why is this happening to these people? What's the reason? Allah says to us, جَزَاءً وِفَاقًا. The reason why these people are being punished like this, their adab is continuous. They're going to be drinking this. This is why they're going to be deprived from cold water. What did they do wrong? Why? What happened? Allah says, the reason I'm doing this is جَزَاءً وِفَاقًا. What does جَزَاءً وِفَاقًا mean? An exact recompenses towards what? According to their evil crimes. The crimes that they did, this is exactly the result of it. They are only tasting the outcome of their actions. They're the ones who did this to themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only rewarding them based on what their action was. وَلِذَلِكَ five of the great mufassirin, they said, Ibn Abbas, Mujahid ibn Jabrin, Qatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi, Al-Rabi' and ibn Zayd, five of these scholars of tafsir, all five of them said, ثَوَابًا مُوَافِقًا لِأَعْمَالِهِمْ. This is in accordance to the action that they put forward. They came with kufr and disbelief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now because they came with that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is judging them based on what their hands have put forward. So when you come the day of judgment, and you're being, and you, sorry, if since you're in this world today and you have this opportunity, look at every action that you do. وَلِذَلِكَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى is going to tell us later what the believers are going to receive, and inshallah ta'ala, some matters pertain to that, we'll expand on it later. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to saying, إِنَّهُمْ they were verily, لَا يَرْجُونَ حِسَابًا. Allah now explains more to us why He's punishing them. And He doesn't have to, but Allah chooses to do. He says, إِنَّهُمْ they كانوا they were, they used to, لَا يَرْجُونَ حِسَابًا. They used to not look for a reckoning. That's one view. There's four opinions regarding what's meant by لَا يَرْجُونَ حِسَابًا. Number one, the first view is لَا يَخَافُونَ حِسَابًا. They never used to fear the punishment of Allah and that Allah is going to account them. The fear was missing from them. So the first reason why these people are being punished like this and they're being destroyed like this in the hellfire, number one is what? إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا لَا يَرْجُونَ حِسَابًا. It means أي لَا يَخَافُونَ حِسَابًا. They were not scared. Okay. The second qawl is they were not hoping لَا يَرْجُونَ ثَوَابَ الْحِسَابِ. The second is that they were not hoping for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that awaits them the day of judgment. They didn't hope for that. The third view is لَا يَرْجُونَ. It means أي لَا يَتَوَقَّعُونَ. They didn't even assume that there's going to be an accountability the day of judgment and that they're going to be accounted for what they said and did. And last but not least, إِنَّهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْبَعْثِ. That they did not even believe in the resurrection, that they're going to be resurrected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those are four statements of the great scholars of tafsir. إِنَّهُمْ they were لَا يَرْجُونَ حِسَابًا. They were never scared. These tawaghit, tawaghut is every single person who exceeds his limits that was sent for him. كَانُوا فِي الدُّنْيَا. Whilst they were in this world, لَا يَخَافُونَ. They never were scared. أَنْ يُجَازِيَهُمْ أَحَدٍ. They were never actually scared that they will be accounted for what they came with, their evil actions. So here it is that they're tasting their punishment. So what else did Allah say after that? وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا كِذَّابًا. But they denied our ayat, the universal signs that we sent for them, the sun, the moon, and everything we mentioned before. They all denied everything. And they also denied the verses, the Quran was read on them. They, whilst they were in this world, their parents, their uncles, their friends, everybody was telling them, fear Allah, change your ways. The way you're living is not right. You need to rectify your actions. You need to rectify your speech. Why are you living a life like this? وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا كِذَّابًا. They disbelieved in it. They didn't take those statements serious. Allah gave them many signs. They didn't take those signs serious. What were those signs that Allah gave them? Their friend died. Their other friend died. And their other friend died. And when an angel of death takes those around you, it's a sign that he's coming for you. It's him telling you, get ready, I'm going to come for you soon. But all of those signs, they disbelieved in it. وَكَذَّبُوا They disbelieved. بِآيَاتِنَا Our verses. كِذَّابًا A click of disbelief. So this is, and they didn't believe in the Qur'an. They looked at the Qur'an as, when I grow older, and I become big, I will change. But the angel of death doesn't really look at that, does it? The day it came and it knocked on their door, it didn't ask them, how old are you? Are you young? It took them. وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا كِذَّابًا وَلِذَلِكَ Brothers, I say, the person who believes in these verses, who truly it means a lot to them, and they actually believe in it, it's not just a statement they will say. It will change their life. They will live by it. You'll see it on their face. You'll see it on their limbs. You'll see it in their actions. You'll see their life just fully changed. A person who believes in these verses, today was Jum'ah, he wouldn't have just been at home. He would have been in the masjid, crying, asking Allah. There's a time within the Jum'ah that if a person asks Allah, Allah accepts his dua. The person who believes in these verses, these are the things that he's going to come with. The Messenger told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that the person who recites Ayatul Kursi after every prayer, the only thing that he awaits for entering Jannah is death. All he has to wait for is death. And then as soon as that, he will enter Jannah. So the one who believes in these verses is going to take all of that serious. And his life and his actions are going to be changed. If you don't believe in them, you're going to come with nothing. وَكَذَّبُوا They disbelieved. بِآيَاتِنَا Our verses. كِذَّابًا They disbelieved. So they didn't believe what the Qur'an came with. Allah then says, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ And everything أَحْصَيْنَاهُ كِتَابًا Everything that they done, we recorded it in a book. Every statement you say, Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, the slave of Allah, male or female, every single statement that you have ever said that you forgot, Allah hasn't forgot it. مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ Every single statement that you've said, that you forgot, Allah to him is documented. هذا كتابنا ينطق عليكم بالحق إنا كنا نستنسخ ما كنتم تعملون. This is our book. Every single thing that you used to do, we documented it for you. So you don't disbelieve it. This was the date that you said it. This is the place that you did it. Everything will be placed in front of you. Allah says in another ayah, إنا رسولنا our messenger, our angels. إن رسلنا our messengers they were writing يكتبون ما تمكرون the plotting and the planning and the evil things that you were doing behind closed doors in the dark Allah says all of that our angels were writing it and they were documenting everything you were doing and Allah says in another ayah وكل إنسان ألزمناه طائره في عنقه ونخرج له يوم القيامة كتابا يلقاه منشورا اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا That day, your book will be brought out in front of you. And it will be said to you, اقرأ كتابك, read your book, O slave. كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا. This book is sufficient for you to busy yourself with. This is it. It will take all your time. Because it has every single thing. As Allah said in another ayah, ووضع الكتاب فترى المجرمين مشفقين مما فيه ويقولون يا ويلتنا ما لهذا الكتاب لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها ووجدوا ما عملوا حاضرا ولا يظلم ربك أحدا Everything they did, the little, the big, the small, everything you ever said and did, it's documented, it's right in front of you. What is this book? What is this book that has not left anything behind, that he has documented all my life? Allah tells us subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah already knows. But you know what the powerful thing here is? It's not just Allah is judging you based on His knowledge. Allah is also judging you based on what you're going to read, your documents. It's in front of you. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is not one you can deceive. Today, if you go to a court of law, if you go to a court, you could get a good lawyer and you can get away with some big crimes that you've done. If your back pocket is swollen, and you got money, and you can get the right links, and you can get the best lawyers. You might walk away in that courtroom, being an innocent person and blaming all the crimes on somebody else. But the day of judgment, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, He knows every single thing. So, my beloved brothers and sisters, ponder here and think. Ask yourself, when you fall into these sins that you fall into, and you do these crimes that you do. Ask yourself, you wouldn't even say that in front of your parents, and you wouldn't say that in front of, you know, a righteous person in the family. Why would you say that in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why would you do that in front of your Lord? Why would you do this and say this in front of the angels? Why are you going to make Allah the lowest of those who look at you? وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ Everything. The word kul in Arabic language is from the most generic words that show generalization. Are you with me, brothers? It's أَبْلَغُ الْعُمُومَاتِ It's the most powerful when it comes to everything. كُلَّ شَيْءٍ Everything. أَحْصَيْنَاهُ كِتَابًا We have documented it. Not a split second of your life is not documented for us. Everything. ولذلك some of the ulama, they say, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيمٌ عَتِيدٌ The good and the bad. And what about the things that are not good and the bad? Even they're documented. Because of the generalization that's used here. Even the things that are not wrong, that you said, are still documented. Everything is documented that day. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here there's an issue here, brothers. Which is, in the next ayah, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, فَذُوقُوا فَلَن نَزِيدَكُمْ إِلَّا عَذَابًا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here He says. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here He says, فَذُوقُوا, it will be said to them, فَذُوقُوا, taste. Here, the verse says, فَذُوقُوا, so taste. فَلَن نَزِيدَكُمْ, we will not increase you, إِلَّا عَذَابًا, except punishment, and except torment. This is what's going to be said to them. Here the Mufassirin, the scholars of Tafsir, they discuss this verse. Because this verse shows that the people of the Hellfire will be spoken to. Sah. And Allah says in another ayah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَشْتَرُونَ بِأَهْدِ اللَّهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا وَأَيْمَانٍ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا Those who have bought the covenant of Allah and the oath that they took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they bought it with ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا, some small money. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ لَا خَلَاقَ لَهُمْ Those individuals, they have no khalaq, meaning they have nothing with their Lord. وَلَا يُكَلِّمُهُمُ اللَّهُ Allah will not speak to them that day. وَلَا يَنظُرُ إِلَيْهِمْ And Allah will not look at them. يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَا يُزَكِّيهِمْ Allah will not purify them. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ And they have a severe punishment. So this verse clearly says, وَلَا يُكَلِّمُهُمُ اللَّهُ Allah will not speak to them. And the verse that's in front of us here, Allah is saying, فَذُوقُوا taste. So it seems that Allah is speaking to them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do we reconcile between these two verses? One verse is saying Allah does not speak to these people. And another verse, Allah is saying, فَذُوقُوا taste, فَلَن نَزِيدَكُمْ إِلَّا عَذَابًا The Mufassirin, they took two answers in which they responded to this verse. The first one is, وَلَا يُكَلِّمُهُمُ اللَّهُ means Allah will not speak to them a speech that will benefit them. Something that will save them from the punishment of the hellfire will not be told to them. So the speech that's been negated here is not unrestricted. It's a particular type of speech that they won't receive. The speech that they're not going to get is لَا يُكَلِّمُهُمْ كَلَامًا يَنْفَعُهُمْ Allah will not speak to them a speech that will benefit them. Every speech that will be said to them is going to hurt them more. The speeches are going to be a form of punishment for them. They're not going to receive any kind words from their Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one statement. The other statement is that when Allah says in this ayah, وَلَا يُكَلِّمُهُمْ Allah will not speak to them, أَنَّ مَوَاقِفَ الْقِيَامَةِ تَتَعَدَّدْ That the day of judgment, the stages are different. So some places Allah will not speak to them, and in some other places He will speak to them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those are the two responses that the scholars have given, rahimahumullahu jami'an. This is what's going to be said to them. فَذُوقُوا taste, فَلَن نَزِيدَكُمْ We will not increase in for you إِلَّا عَذَابًا except a punishment. If you look at the Qur'an and you ponder on the Qur'an, you always find Allah talks about the people of the hellfire and the punishment that awaits the people of the hellfire. And what does He always do after that? He mentions the people of righteousness. The righteous slaves of Allah, the muttaqeen, the people who are obedient to Him and are following His command, Allah always also mentions them. And this is something you can always see in the Qur'an. Allah mentions the kuffar, Allah mentions the mujrimeen, and then Allah goes to the muttaqeen and the mu'mineen. So Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala now, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازًا Allah moves on to the muttaqeen. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازًا حَدَائِقَ وَأَعْنَابًا إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ For the muttaqeen, those who have taqwa, there will be a success. Inna lilmuttaqina mafaza. For them will be success. Here the word mafaza, the scholars have explained it with two explanations. Some scholars have said unrestricted success. So they said mutlaqul fawz, unrestricted success. Which basically is, they are going to receive everything they've ever wanted. And they're also going to be prevented from every evil that they ever wanted to stay away from. Stay away from, and they didn't want to come to them, it won't. The second view of the Mufassirin is, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازٍ. And here specifically means that the mafaz specifically means Jannah, that's it. Not unrestricted foes, success. It specifically just means Jannah. So the muttaqin for them is mafaza. And if you look at the two qawl, they come together. Because in Jannah, there's unrestricted success. مَا لَعَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. Eyes have never seen it, ears have never heard of it, and it has never come to the heart of any believer what's in Jannah. And now you're going to see powerful descriptions for Jannah. What does Allah want from us, brothers? This is the thing Allah wants. Allah wants you to be scared. And Allah now wants you to have hope. All of the things that were mentioned about the people of the hellfire and the punishment that they're going to go through is fear that's needed from you. And now hope. Hope for Jannah and to be from the muttaqin. Because if Allah only tells you about the disbelievers and the punishment of the hellfire, you might give up in life. That's what Allah says in the Quran. نَبِّ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ وَقَابِلِ التَّوْبِ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ ذِي الطَّوْلِ. Allah always mentions it like that, the Quran. Fear, غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ, and also غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ وَقَابِلِ التَّوْبِ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. He's ghafir, he forgives, and he's shadidul iqab. And if he wants to punish you, he'll punish you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these two wings is what a bird needs to fly with. The wing of hope and the wing of fear. With those two, you can fly. If you try to worship Allah only on fear, then you take the path of the khawarij. And if you only worship Allah based on the path of hope, then you've taken the path of the murji'ah. And if you worship Allah only on love, you've taken the path of the sufiya. You need to worship Allah with those three. Al-khawf wal-raja wal-mahabba. Fear, hope, and love. All together, when it comes together, that's what the mu'mineen are like. Not one overcomes the other. That's why Allah now is telling us, إِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازًا. For the muttaqeen, ikhwani, what is a muttaqeen? A muttaqeen, what is this person who came with this characteristics? Balq ibn Habib, rahimahullah, he gave the best definition of taqwa. His definition of taqwa is, does anyone know the definition that Talq ibn Habib gave, rahimahullah ta'ala, towards taqwa? Because now we speak about taqwa, some of you may not even know what it means. And if you don't know what taqwa means, how are you going to attain what you don't understand? Does anyone know the definition? This is the best definition that has been given regarding a taqwa. I think we should make this a homework then. Next tafsir lesson, everybody try to look up Talq ibn Habib, what he said regarding a taqwa. It's important. That is the best definition that is being given regarding a taqwa. It is a comprehensive definition. His name is Talq ibn Habib, rahimahullah. He gave the best definition. Inna lilmuttaqina mafaza. For the people of taqwa is success by attaining Jannah, by being distanced from the hellfire.